Listening Library presents Extra Life, Young Readers Adaptation, the astonishing story of how we doubled our lifespan. This is the author, Stephen Johnson. From my mother. Introduction. It may not feel like it if you check the news, but you are living in a world that is far safer than the one in which your great-great-grandparents lived. Countless everyday experiences that used to pose terrible threats to our lives now pose no meaningful health risk at all. That glass of milk you had with dinner last night? A little more than a century ago, it might have contained germs that could cause the deadly disease tuberculosis. The scrape on your knee from falling off your longboard? That might have triggered a fatal infection just 80 years ago. Driving a car is 10 times safer than it was when people first got behind the wheel. There are 1,000 other improvements in health and safety like these, but they all add up to one amazing statistic, maybe the most important statistic of all. It's what we call life expectancy, the number of years that the average person born at a given place and time can expect to live. Take the long-term trends in the United Kingdom, where they've been measuring life expectancy the longest. In 1660, it was just over 30 years. In 1800, it was roughly 40 years. Today, it's over 80. The average person born in the United States a century ago could expect to live a little more than 40 years. Today, that number is just below 80 years. And Americans are 4 times more likely to live into their hundreds than they were a few decades ago. It's an incredible transformation, and it's not just happening in wealthy countries like the United States or the United Kingdom. 100 years ago, life expectancy in India was only 25 years. Now it's 70 years. As a species, it's as though we've been given an entire extra life to live compared to our ancestors. Some of that extra life is the result of elderly people living longer. Think about your own extended family. Many of us have grandparents or great-grandparents who are in their 80s or 90s. Living that long is normal now, but it didn't used to be. Another major factor in the story of life expectancy is how it changed what it means to be a child. For most of human history, about 1/3 of all children died before they turned 18. Today, it's closer to 1 in 100. So why isn't the story of extended life something we hear about all the time? Why isn't it front page news? Because, most of the time, it doesn't involve the sudden dramatic changes that draw media attention. The changes that made our world so much safer were subtle, incremental ones. They were slow and steady. In the long run, they add up to the most momentous transformation you could imagine. But in the short run, they are often invisible. One of the reasons we have a hard time recognizing this kind of progress is that, by definition, it is measured in non-events. The smallpox infection that didn't kill you at age 2, the lead paint that didn't give you brain damage, the drinking water that didn't poison you with cholera. We don't tend to think about these kinds of things for a good reason. They didn't happen. But they might well have happened if you or I had been born just 2 centuries ago, even in the wealthiest countries in the world. Think about it this way. We build monuments and pay tribute to the lives lost in wars or great tragedies, and that makes sense. But we don't have a habit of building monuments that celebrate deaths that didn't happen, monuments to all the lives saved. Maybe it's time we did. In a sense, human beings have been increasingly protected by an invisible shield, one that has been built piece by piece over the last few centuries, keeping us ever safer and further from death. It protects us through countless interventions, big and small, the chlorine in our drinking water, the vaccinations that rid the world of smallpox, the data centers mapping disease outbreaks all around the planet. A crisis like the global pandemic that began in 2020 gives us a new perspective on all that progress. Pandemics have an interesting tendency to make that invisible shield suddenly and briefly visible. For once, we're reminded of how dependent everyday life is on medical science, hospitals, public health authorities, drug supply chains, and more. And an event like the COVID-19 crisis does something else as well. It helps us perceive the holes in that shield, the vulnerabilities, the places where we need new scientific breakthroughs, new systems, new ways of protecting ourselves from emergent threats. Most history books focus on a central topic, a person, event, or place, a great leader, a military conflict, a city, or a nation. This book, by contrast, tells the story of a number, the rising life expectancy of the world's population, giving us an entire extra life in merely one century. It should help you understand where that progress came from, the breakthroughs and collaborations and institutions that had to be invented to make it possible. Some of the heroes of this story were scientists or doctors, but not all. Some of them were ordinary people who fought to improve the health of our species by writing articles or organizing protests or sharing an important breakthrough they had discovered in another culture. But they were all people who had a vision of how the world could be made a better place and who had the daring and the commitment to turn that vision into a reality. This book tells the story of how they pulled it off. Chapter 1. The Speckled Monster. Vaccines. If you had been born 3 centuries ago, the list of potential illnesses or accidents that could threaten your life would be very different from that list today. You would be at no risk from automobile or plane crashes, or from being accidentally electrocuted, because none of those technologies existed in the early 1700s. That would be the good news. But for the most part, the list of potential threats would be much longer than it is now. Getting a simple cut or scrape, the sort of thing that you'd put a Band-Aid on now and forget about, could easily lead to a deadly infection back then. The simple act of drinking water, particularly in big towns and cities, could give you a disease like typhoid. But for many people in the early 1700s, the most terrifying threat they faced was a virus. Scientists later gave it the name variola major when they finally identified it in microscopes a century and a half later. The disease it caused went by another name, smallpox. Smallpox had been a scourge since at least the age of the great Egyptian pyramids. The mummy of Ramses V has visible scars on his face from the pustules that form on the skin of smallpox victims. In some European cities between 1650 and 1750, smallpox accounted for more than 15% of all deaths recorded. Young children were particularly vulnerable to the disease. In Sweden during the 18th century, 90% of smallpox deaths occurred in children under the age of 10. Parents lived with the knowledge that at any moment their child could come down with a fever, followed by the telltale rash, and within a matter of days, the child would be dead, often followed in short order by their siblings. Compared to our modern experience, the whole notion of childhood was inverted. Today, we think of children as emblems of vitality and resilience, the vigor of youth. But in the age of smallpox, childhood was fundamentally linked to sudden and catastrophic illness. Being a child in 1700 was dangerous. No amount of wealth or education could protect you from the speckled monster, as smallpox was sometimes called. The list of European leaders felled by smallpox between 1600 and 1800 staggers the mind. During the outbreak of 1711 alone, smallpox killed Holy Roman Emperor Joseph I, 3 siblings of the future Holy Roman Emperor Francis I, and the heir to the French throne, the Grand Dauphin Louis. Over the next 70 years, the disease claimed King Louis I of Spain, Emperor Peter II of Russia, Louise Hippolyte, Princess of Monaco, King Louis XV of France, and Maximilian III Joseph, Elector of Bavaria. These were some of the richest people in the world, living in vast palaces with access to the finest healthcare of the day, and they were just as likely to succumb to smallpox as a common laborer. Smallpox was an equal opportunity killer. It's no accident, then, that one of the first major breakthroughs in the history of medicine was a response to the speckled monster. It's a famous story, famous enough to sometimes appear in history books that don't usually give enough attention to advances in human health. The story goes like this. In the late 1790s, an English doctor named Edward Jenner observed a strange pattern in the smallpox cases he was seeing in the rural community where he practiced. Milkmaids seemed less likely than the average resident to contract smallpox.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.